Good morning, friends of St. Peter's, and welcome to our 11 o'clock service. You are in for a treat today. This is John Williams Sunday. So the music will be filled with very familiar tunes from John Williams' movie music. And you'll notice our friends here, a number of them are dressed appropriately. We have a Princess Leia and a Jedi and a Superwoman. So a fun Sunday indeed. We hope you will find that link for your bulletin and sing along with the hymns, which will be offered to a very familiar tune, just not the hymn tune you're used to. And do like and share this video so that your friends and family can join us. We're delighted today to have with us Paul and Scott as our readers. Catherine and Kevin are joining us along with Tasha and Paul as our musicians. Deacon Bob will proclaim the gospel, and Reverend Martha has a beautiful sermon for us today, and I will be your celebrant. We begin with our opening hymn, After the Sound of the Bell. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Glory to God, to grace to the Son, to the love to the Spirit, yet free and yet one. Glory to God, to grace to the Son, to the love to the Spirit, yet free and yet one. Glory to God, to grace to the Son, to the love to the Spirit, yet free and yet one.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O Lord, mercifully receive the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that they may know and understand what things they ought to do, and also may have grace and power faithfully to accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. These are the descendants of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel the Aramene of Padamaram, sister of Laban the Aramene. Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife because she was barren. And the Lord granted his prayer, and his wife Rebekah conceived. The children struggled together within her, and she said, "If it is to be this way, why do I live?" So she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples born of you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other, the elder shall serve the younger." When her time to give birth was at hand, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all his body like a hairy mantle. So they named him Esau. Afterward, his brother came out with his hand gripping Esau's heel. So he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. When the boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man living in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he was fond of the game. But Rebekah loved Jacob. Once when Jacob was cooking a stew, Esau came in from the field and he was famished. Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stuff, for I am famished." Therefore, he was called Edom. Jacob said, "First sell me your birthright." Esau said, "I am about to die. Of what is as a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me first." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus, Esau despised his birthright. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please join in reading the psalm responsively by half verse. Your word is a lantern to my feet,
and a light upon my path.
I have sworn and am determined
to keep your righteous judgments.
I am deeply troubled.
Preserve my life, O Lord, according to your word.
Accept, O Lord, the willing tribute of my lips.
And teach me your judgments.
My life is always in my hand.
Yet I do not forget your law.
The wicked have set a trap for me.
But I have not strayed from your commandments.
Your decrees are my inheritance forever.
Truly, they are the joy of my heart.
I have applied my heart to fulfill your statutes.
Forever and to the end. A reading from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for the laws of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you who are not in the flesh, you who are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. The Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through the Spirit that dwells in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, who created us, Jesus Christ, who redeemed us, and the Holy Spirit, who sanctifies and sustains us. Amen. My grandmother loved to grow flowers, and every year I grow sweet peas in her honor. I plant seeds and watch for any sign of tiny green growth to emerge from the soil. And then I see those tiny tendrils emerge, seeking a place to grasp. And they start growing in earnest. It seems like an inch overnight for weeks. And then they are 6 and 7 feet tall. They end up like this. This is the last of them this year. The little tendrils that seek the place to grasp, the fragrant blossoms of sweet peas and sweet memories of my grandmother. Well, then the waning period begins. Seed pods form and dry out. And it wasn't until my next door neighbor suggested that I harvest the seeds that I realized I didn't just need to cut that all down and toss it into the recycling bin every year. And what I discovered with those seed pods is one of God's beautiful miracles. The seed pods dry out They twist into spirals. And so that the children don't get all the fun, here you can see how they dry out and turn into this spiral. And as the pod continues to dry, the spiral gets tighter and tighter and tighter, so that the seeds are released into the air through the spaces that are there but are decreasing in the spiral. They are literally pushed out of the pod by the pod itself to perpetuate sweet peace in the world. And this is what those little seeds in the pod look like before they are actually launched in the next stage of where these little seeds would go. Well, where those seeds land is anyone's guess. The wind, the humidity level, obstacles here and there, all sorts of factors bear on where they land and take root, including my next door neighbor's bird bath, which attracts a lot of birds who like these seeds too. Around my house, I had sweet peas pushing through wood chips on walkways, emerging through cracks in concrete, popping up on the opposite side of the house from where they'd been planted. They were everywhere. And my sweet pea adventure reminds me of Jesus's parable of the sower, or what could also be called the parable of the soil, because it's really about the relationship between the two, isn't it? It's good to know what a parable actually is. And you mathematicians know what a parabola is. That is the origin of the word parable, para from the Greek to come alongside, like a parallel line or parallelogram, and bole to throw. So a parable is not intended for easy listening and entertainment. It's a way to convey truth by storytelling in a way that shakes us up and wakes us up. Like the parable of the Good Samaritan, think of that. Who was the righteous person in that story? An outsider, someone loathed by the Jewish community. And the parable of the prodigal son. Sons did not disown their fathers. Fathers did not run out of their homes to welcome home a derelict son. Those are shocking stories. And by the way, we start a book study this Sunday on the return of the prodigal son, a story of homecoming, a beautiful book by Henry Nouwen. And the details for that coming up later, but I invite you to join us in examining that beautiful, beautiful parable. So parables were a common teaching mechanism in Jesus's time. And today's story is a classic. So Jesus starts the story with a farmer, simple enough. The farmer has seeds. A farmer broadcasts the seeds, as it's called, different from placing them one by one in perfect little furrows like I did with my sweet pea seeds. Imagining like opening a paper fan in front of you and just walking along, seeds dispersing everywhere. To us in 21st century urban life, there's no real surprise element here. They're just seeds. And how extravagant can tossing seeds be? Well, imagine it's near the end of the 19th century. It's the late 1870s, early 1880s. And you live in a tiny town in Norway, almost at the Arctic Circle. Your family and the families of everyone in the town are fisher folk. For as many generations as people have lived there, that's what they do. And you, destined to be the next fisherman in the family, and I say fishermen because they were all men, you decide that you need more than that life has to offer. You want education. You want to break out of the mold and the predictability of your life. So you and your wife and your children, together with perhaps several other families with the same dreams, leave your homeland, come to America, and you carve a living somehow out of the prairie, the prairies of Western Minnesota and North Dakota and South Dakota. And one day on a trip to another village of settlers, you discover they have seeds. Seeds to grow grain for wheat. Seeds you can plant for your survival. And so you buy several bags of seeds, trusting that proper planting and good care will yield life for you and your family. And the man who sells them to you says, be sure that you clean them really, really well, because that is crucial to their success. So you haul them home, you begin to sort and clean them with great care, and the character in the scene I'm describing experiences their holiness, and I quote from the book that I'll tell you about. His wonder grew as he gazed at the kernels. There they lay, so inanimate, yet so plump and heavy, glowing with smoldering flame. It was as if each kernel had light within it, life now asleep. For someone with a reverent relationship with the land, Jesus' parable of the sower broadcasting seeds without care as to where they landed is sheer foolishness, and possibly ruinous. Ah, but maybe not. God's word in any form has light in it, the potential for life wherever it lands. God errs on the side of lavishness, of generosity. The more sown, the better. The extravagant sower takes a chance that the seed will grow wherever it lands. God takes a chance on us. God has cast many seeds, countless seeds, over the generations and eons of human on earth. How many seeds has God strewn about to reveal God's ways, God's heart, God's desire for justice and peace, and fullness of life for all living things? Many seeds, prophets, saints, God's son, with no guarantee of return. Sometimes we get it, sometimes we don't. And God takes a chance on all of us, every single person. On Jacob, the totally unlikable trickster, who became the father of the 12 tribes of Israel. On Sarah, who throws Hagar out into the wilderness with her baby and then bears a child herself. On Jesus' first disciples, all of whom abandoned him at the time of his death, yet after his death and resurrection, witnessed and died for Christ. God takes a chance on you and on me, and on the community of St. Peter's. We are both soil and seed. Each of us has potential to yield something for God. The quantity isn't important. Did you notice that the parable had differing amounts of yield? The key is to yield something, anything. And we carry the light of Christ within us, the potential to ignite that spark in others through the power of this Spirit. God takes a chance on all of us. Will we squander it, or will we honor it? Amen.
Let us recite together the Nicene Creed, the foundation of our Christian faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As we prepare for the prayers of the people, I want to encourage you, if you're celebrating a birthday or an anniversary this week, to let us know in the comments, both on YouTube or on Facebook, so that we can celebrate with you.
Send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Mercifully receive our prayers, O God, that we may know your ways and follow where you lead, responding,
"Hear us, good Lord."
For those who are seeking a spiritual home, that they may be inspired to visit our churches and to receive a deep sense of God's presence through our worship together and the hospitality we share, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
That we may be set free from the need to claim our worthiness through possessions and position, so that we may discover our true identity in the life and hope of the Holy Spirit, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
That the light of Christ will reveal the path to those for whom the shadows are long, the poor and desperate, the lonely and unemployed, the hungry and fearful, the refugees and homeless, the prisoner, and those who live as if in prison, that we may not forget them, let us pray. For our Commander-in-Chief and all who serve in the armed forces, that we may be thankful for their many sacrifices and honor the service they render to our country and to the security of the world, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
For those who have died, that they may reside in the place where there is no sorrow or pain, but life everlasting, let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
For safety for children who are on vacation, that they may have the chance to learn new skills, build healthy bodies, and develop new and lasting friendships. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
Holy God, mighty God, immortal God, adored by angels and praised by the saints, receive the prayers of your holy church and grant them in accordance with your gracious will through Christ our Lord.
O most mighty and merciful God, in this time of great sickness, we flee to you for relief and comfort. Deliver us, we beseech you, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use for their cure. Comfort those who mourn or who are in great financial distress. Endue our leaders with wisdom and courage, and grant that, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts to that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lord, listen to your children pray. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Children praying, send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy upon us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And may the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Please do share with one another the signs of God's peace, knowing we share that peace with you. And we come to our birthday and anniversary prayer. So we lift up in our hearts all those who are celebrating this week as we pray. Watch over thy servants, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may thy peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of their lives through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we come to the offertory again, I want to thank you for your ongoing and continued generosity to St. Peter's. It is humbling to see your generosity in such a challenging time, and we're so grateful. You are welcome to contribute towards the mission and ministry of God at St. Peter's in a number of ways. One way is by text to give. You can text 858-252-0622. You can also give online at our parish website, stpetersdelmar.net/give, or by the good old postal service. And our P.O. Box is P.O. Box 336, Del Mar, California, 92014, with our deep gratitude. Walk in love, as Christ loves us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
So even though there's no music printed in your bulletin, if you know the tune, sing along. Why not? It would be fun.
Come. turns from glory into glory, till in heaven take our place, till we cast our crowns before thee, lost in wonder, love, and
as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
And let us pray together the general thanksgiving. God, our creator, our center, our friend, we thank you for our good life, for those who are dear to us, for our dead, and for all who have helped and influenced us. We thank you for the measure of freedom we have and the extent to which we control our lives. And most of all, we thank you for the faith that is in us, for our awareness of you and our hope in you. Keep us, we pray you, thankful and hopeful and useful until our lives shall end. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you on this day and always. Amen. What a fun and beautiful service. Thank you so much to our musicians for adding such wonderful color to our liturgy today, and to Scott and Paul for being our readers, Reverend Martha, your beautiful sermon, and Deacon Bob, always, for your leadership in proclaiming the good news. It was fun to share the service with you this morning. I wonder, Tasha, could you speak to us a little bit about our Sunday best and announce what you'll find in your bulletin? Tasha, could you tell us a little more?
Yes, absolutely. So in an effort to stay connected with all of you while we're all still at home, I'm urging everybody to participate from home in our Sunday themes, our Sunday musical themes. So every time there is an applicable costume day, like today, for John Williams Sunday, for Harry Potter, which is coming up the end of this month. There will also be opportunities for Disney and musical theater, and of course, Aloha to Summer. For each one of those, we're gonna ask you to create and or dress up in your favorite costume and share those pictures with us on social media. If you don't already follow us on Instagram, at St. Peter's Del Mar, please do so and tag us in those photos using the hashtag SundayBestDay. You can also tag us in those on Facebook as well. And if you are on neither of those platforms but still want to participate in the fun, please do email those photos to Janine Hand, that's J-Hand, H-A-N-D, at stpetersdelmar.net. And we will feature some of those in our Spirit and Times, most likely, and possibly in other of our church publications. And on the Sundays where there are not necessarily costume opportunities, there will be other ways to participate. So definitely do look for those updates on your social media platforms. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tasha. Reverend Martha, you referenced some wonderful books today in your sermon. Would you like to speak a little bit more about both of them, actually?
Sure. Two books. The first, as I mentioned, is the subject of our book study that begins at 10 o'clock on Sunday morning. That's July 12th. And we'll do it for the balance of July and possibly even a week or two into August, depending on how leisurely of a pace we want to take in studying this book together and sharing its beauty. I realize this looks reversed when I show it to you, but you can at least see the photo here, which is Rembrandt's Return of the Prodigal Son painting. And this book is written by the Reverend Henry, H-E-N-R-I-J-N, Nouwen, N-O-U-W-E-N. And it's really the story of his spiritual journey when he encountered this painting and experienced the painting. And as a result of his experience with the painting and in its presence, really started on a spiritual journey about understanding his own belovedness before God and his place in God's kingdom and in God's heart. And so it's really a wonderful invitation for each of us to experience the painting as well, and our own sort of maybe parables as we study this most wonderful and favorite and fun parable of the prodigal son. The second book came about as a result of the sacred groundwork that many of us are starting to become engaged in at St. Peter's in connection with the racial reconciliation work of the Episcopal Church. And one aspect of the sacred groundwork is for us to really acknowledge and appreciate our own heritage in some way. And as European Americans, how our ancestors attempted to assimilate, survive first and then assimilate into culture here and become citizens of what then became the United States. And so this book, Giants in the Earth, and the author is Rolvaag, R-O-L-V-A-A-G, which is, of course, a Norwegian man, and it was translated from the Norwegian. It's the story of a family with two or three other families who do actually emigrate to this country in the late 1800s and try to survive on the prairie of North America. And the subtitle to this is A Saga of the Prairie, in case you want to locate it, and we'll put it in the chat stream, as I mentioned. But my own family history on my father's side is of Norwegian immigrants, and much of that story is lost to me. And this book was suggested to me by one of the members in my Sacred Ground Circle. And it has been a wonderful discovery that I know paralleled much of my own family's history and experiences there. And when I came upon this, I actually had finished the book last week, and then thinking about the parable of the sower and the preciousness of seeds and the role that really the holiness of each and every kernel to this man trying to help his family survive on the prairie was just too much to pass up. So thank you for being with me in that this morning.
Well, thank you for showing how the Sacred Ground curriculum really helps us unpack our own history and our own heritage and our own sacrifices that our ancestors made, regardless of where they came from, in order to fit in here. And there's a beauty to that. And if others are interested in joining this curriculum, this engaging this curriculum on racial reconciliation, what should they do, Martha?
Well, you could email me, manderson@stpetersdelmar.net, and just say, hey, tell me more about Sacred Ground and racial reconciliation work. You can also access a web page that is actually under construction right now, but I hope to have it up by early this coming week. And so we'll have some resources there where you can investigate some of the work that the church is doing. And there are two circles now in session at St. Peter's, and a third one is forming to begin at the end of August. There are a few slots left for that if you're interested in exploring it and really going on the journey that this curriculum takes you, which is truly astonishing in both its breadth and its depth. Then please do let me know again at my email address, and you can join the introductory conversation around that at the end of August.
Thank you so much, Reverend Martha. Tomorrow, Nancy Burnett begins her next workshop she's offering this summer called Mending Life.
Hello, I'm Nancy Burnett, inviting you to the workshop Mending Life, Healing Through Christian Practices of Gratitude and Reconciliation. In this workshop, we will deepen our understanding of Scripture that speaks directly to brokenness and mending. And we will use our guidebook, otherwise known as the Book of Common Prayer, and other resources to explore how we can apply this understanding at home and beyond. In discussions, we will consider brokenness that touches you. I hope you will find new hope through new practices to apply in your life. And the joy of coming together to learn together can be healing in itself. I hope you will join me for 4 Monday sessions beginning July 13th, 10 to 11:30 on Zoom. To get the link, call St. Peter's office at 858-755-1616, extension 100, or email Vicki at vharney@stpetersdelmar.net. And Vicki can forward any questions you may have. Thanks. See you soon.
And she wanted me to make sure you knew that she's making an offline opportunity as well. So if you've just had enough Zoom screens, and like this is about what you can manage, like, okay, work and a screen for church. She's doing an offline version of this. So do be in touch. Given that the program starts tomorrow, probably the swiftest way to get in touch with Nancy is actually to email me, and I can get you in touch with her. My email address is pblair@stpetersdelmar.net, and we'll make that connection with you as this wonderful workshop on reconciliation and forgiveness allows us a chance to truly heal our lives and live into those lives that God has given us more fully. Are there other announcements that I should be making today that I have forgotten, friends? Okay. Well, our final hymn this morning is another familiar tune you're going to love. We'll sing Ye Servants of God, Your Master Proclaim, to the theme of Star Wars.
Wonderful name, the name of victory.
Go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.